Well, this morning, I have a title for you, message for you. And my title for you this morning is, Welcome to Gilgal. You may wonder, what is this? Yeah, Gilgal is a place that is mentioned in the Bible. And that place has many experiences. So I believe God is going to give us similar experiences right this morning. And before you move on, before you enter into 2019, it's better we go through these experiences of Gilgal. And I know that as we have come to the very end of this year, 2018, I think in a day or few hours, we are here to say goodbye, 2018. And then it becomes a history of our life, no more an experience. And then we are going to enter into a brand new year of 2019. Amen? I tell you, friends, time is the best gift that God has given to every human in this world. Amen? No matter who you are, that is a precious gift that God has given to every one of us. But what we do with the time is a gift back to God. Amen? The way we use the time, profitable for the kingdom of God, is such a gift back to God. Sometimes we don't understand the value of time that God has given to our lives. Well, I'm going to talk to you this morning right from the book of Joshua, from the chapters 4 and 5. You may open your Bible to the book of Joshua 4 and 5. Fourth and fifth chapters of Joshua. And keep it open. I may quote the verses here now and then so you can follow with me. We see that the people of Israelites were once in bondage in Egypt. And they were slaves in the land of Egypt. God did not make the human, his people, to be slaves or to be under bondage. God delivered them, brought them out of the land of Egypt. And there was a period where the people of Israelites were in the wilderness. But that was not God's plan for them to just stay in wilderness. God had promised them to lead them into the land of the promise. What is that? The land of Canaan. God wanted them to enter into the land of Canaan. So God was beautifully guiding them and leading them. Through all the wilderness, God was supplying every need of their lives. God took care of every minute detail, cares for these people. Isn't our God so good to us? He's taking so good care of us. You know, when I say so many reasons to be thankful to God, that is right from the very breath that we breathe. We have to be thankful. None of us can sit back and say, oh, it doesn't mean anything to me. No, the very breath that you have is a gift. You need to be thankful to God. So this people of Israelites, they were seeing wonders, signs, and miracles all through their journey in wilderness. But God wanted them to enter into the land of his promise, land of Canaan. So they had to cross River Jordan. You know, God made them to cross the Red Sea, and the next, another giant step was for them is to cross River Jordan. In both experiences, God parted the waters, and they walked through the river and through the sea just like they were walking on a bare ground. Isn't that wonderful? All through our problems, God led us so wonderfully and brought us to this level. Amen? So when God led them and brought them crossing River Jordan, the first destination that they camped in the land of the promise, Canaan, was Gilgal. So this is what I want you all to meditate and concentrate on, this destination. All the experiences that these people of Israelites had, I believe God is going to give us the similar experiences to every one of us this morning. Are you ready for that? Hallelujah. You know, the name Gilgal is mentioned about 39 times in the Bible. But in these chapters in Joshua, we're going to concentrate what these people went through in this place. The first thing that I would mark out the mention is, this became a place of remembrance. Remembrance of all the wonders, miracles that the Lord did in the lives of these people, Israelites. You know, God took such wonderful care. He made them to cross the river Jordan without any struggle. They walked as though they walked on a bare ground. So when they came to the shore, that was the other destination, was Gilgal. You know what God told Joshua? It is written in the 4th chapter, verses from 19 to 24. You may open the Bible and go through that and read it later. When these people, Israelites, crossed the river Jordan, they came to this point of Gilgal. God told Joshua, hey, ask your leaders to collect 12 stones and let them bring the 12 stones and put them as a monument. Gather them. In other words, make them as an altar. And let those 12 stones gathered up and lined up, let them stay there as a sign of remembrance of all the wonders and miracles you people enjoyed. You know, we are sitting here this morning. You know, 12 stones, I would say, the past 12 months that we have crossed through. God has been so good every month of this year. January, February, March. You know, nowadays it's not difficult for you to recollect all your past experiences. All that you have to go through is through your cell phones, iPhones, all the photos has date and time, everything. It gives you all the records. Well, it's not easy to forget. But you know, going through all these experiences we know, crossing all the 12 months, we are on the very last days of this year end. We are here to remember the goodness that God has shown in our lives all through these 12 months. Never take it for granted. Nothing happens by chance. All by the goodness and mercies of God. Amen. I love all the worship songs that our worship team did. You know, we are here, we are this morning to say, I surrender, Lord. All that it means is you are the one who has led me so far. And here again, I depend on you. You're the one who would lead me on. Well, sometimes I would say, why not many times? Our soul is very foolish. It's easy for the soul to forget the benefits and the goodness that we receive from God. Very soon our soul forgets. Oh, yesterday you had such a wonderful biryani. Oh yeah, that was yesterday. What about today? You know, very easily we change and think of things for granted. Now, King David says in such a beautiful way in Psalm 103, he says, he talks to his soul, hey soul, don't forget, remember the goodness, the blessings, the benefits, and all the mercies and grace that you enjoyed from the hands of God Almighty. I think all of us know this psalm by heart. Am I right? You know, those days we all used to recite this Bible, verses at the end of the service. But now, doesn't matter. But even if you don't recite it, I know it's a beautiful passage that better for us to keep it in mind. I think I'm going to quote it from NKJV, Psalm 103 from verses 1 to 5. Are you ready to say that with me? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Well, they make it so easy for us. Come on. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Amen. It doesn't finish there. It says, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. Think about so many sicknesses that was in the air, but God protected you and me. Amen. And he kept you. And even the little sickness that you went through, he healed you. And he brought you safe and sound at the year end. We are here to say, bless the Lord for that. Hallelujah. And then who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things. How many of you enjoyed good things all this year, 2018? Why not we give a good hand to the Lord and say, thank you, Lord, for all the good things that I've enjoyed. And not only that, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. When you're grateful, you live healthy. And your days will be refreshed, renewed like eagle. Amen? The best life is to live a life of gratitude, thankfulness. Amen? You know, when Jesus healed 10 lepers, it is mentioned in the book of Luke 17 chapter, verse 17 says, Jesus is asking a question, where are the 9? Didn't I heal 10 lepers? Only one man returned back to Jesus to thank and worship him with gratefulness and with a heart of gratitude. But Jesus raised a question. Sometimes we think he's very gracious. He forgets. No. He expects a heart of gratitude, heart of thankfulness. Why not we lift up our hands and say, yes, Lord, I'm grateful. I'm thankful for all the blessings that I enjoyed all through this year of 2018. Everything that I enjoyed, experienced, is from your hands, Lord. I acknowledge it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. This is the question. If you are here in Gilgal, what is your way of expressing gratitude and thankfulness to God? You know what? God told Joshua, put the stones and let the stones stay there as a sign of remembrance for the next generations, for other people to know the way I led you, the way I fed you, the way I've protected you. Proclaim the greatness, the goodness of God. This is what God wanted us to do. Amen? We need to tell somebody how wonderful is our God. Amen? Proclaim and make it as a sign of remembrance. Amen for that. The next experience is what these people went through in the place of Gilgal. By the way, Gilgal also means circle of stones. I would say a circular altar. This morning particularly, we are here to build an altar. I tell you, friends, even tomorrow, if you have time, gather as families, gather as couples, gather as groups, build an altar for the Lord. That's the only way we can express our thankfulness. What can we render back to God for all that he has done to us? Amen? He expects a heart of thankfulness and thanksgiving. The next is, Gilgal means reproach is rolled away. You know, in the verse, 5th chapter, verse 9, I'll read it for you. Then the Lord said to Joshua, this day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. Therefore, the name of the place is called Gilgal to this day. Gilgal means simply the reproach is rolled away. Amen for that. Hallelujah. These people of Israelites lived in the land of Egypt where they were treated so bad. They were slaves. They were beaten. And they were under the bondage. They were not paid. They lived a life of pain, shame, but God brought them out from that land. How many of you are able to identify and relate to the life that we lived in the world? It was full of shame, pain, tears, but God did not leave us there. He brought us out. Amen? Hallelujah. When God brought these people out of the land of Egypt, they were in the wilderness. God took care of everything for them. You know, it was easy for God to bring them out of the land of Egypt, but it wasn't easy for God to remove Egypt from their mind. They carried Egypt in their mind and heart. They always, whatever challenges, experience came, immediately they'll sit and murmur about the lifestyle in Egypt. They'll say, oh, we were so well off in Egypt. We had nice salad. We had garlic. We had cucumber. We had this healthy stuff. But what about our food in the wilderness? There's nothing to eat. Only this, that. These people were always murmuring. You know, God doesn't like people who murmur. Am I right? Amen? God got so mad, irritated with these people. You know what God did finally? He made this. The journey could have been so easy, could have reached in such a short span of time, but he made them to wander in wilderness for 40 years. Why? Just because he wanted this generation to die there. He did not want them to enter into the land of the promise. He waited. Well, watch out, my friends. Never murmur. Never complain. It's easy for us to complain. It's very easy for us to say when the day is so bright and nice, we say, oh, it's too hot. It's too sunny. When the day is cold and cloudy, oh, it's very cold. I wish it was sunny. For everything, we will give a complaint. We're never satisfied for anything. Well, leave that. These people, whatever God provided them in the wilderness, God did such miracles, opened the windows of heaven. He brought manna down for them. Oh, what is this manna? Every day, same food, rice and sambar, rasam. Why this and that? Why not I have a change? They started murmuring. They took things for granted. Finally, God got tired of them and he got irritated. And he said, I'm not going to let these people enter into the land of promise. And this generation almost died in the wilderness. But a new generation, except Caleb and Joshua, they were two men full of faith who followed the ways of God. Well, the next generation who were born in the wilderness, they had not seen Egypt, but all that they know is the experience of wilderness. As soon as they get up, they saw the clouds, they saw manna coming down, they experienced all that. But you know what? God wanted them not to be wanderers in wilderness, but he wanted to train them as conquerors of Canaan. Amen? And God told Joshua, Joshua, get these people ready and circumcise them. And I want to show that I'm related with them. They are mine. I'll embrace them as mine. This is what God is doing to us this morning. God says, she's mine. That person is mine. I want to show the world that they belong to me. And through circumcision, God identified they are separated, chosen people on the face of the earth. Amen? And we, as Christians today, are also circumcised, not maybe in the way that the Jews went through, but our circumcision is, Bible says in Romans 2:29, for he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit. Amen for that. Hallelujah. You know, God, circumcision in a simple way, I will say like this, cut off the fleshly desires. Cut off the flesh from our lives. Amen? Cut off the kind of habits that keep you away from God. Cut off the relationships that hinders your relationship with God. Amen? Cut off those practices and desires that keep you away from God. That is our kind of circumcision this morning. Are you with me, church? Hallelujah. It's time to remove the things that needs to be removed. It's time to cut off the things that needs to be cut off from our lives. Are you ready for that? It's time to burn the things that needs to be burned to ashes. Then God wants to do something new in our lives. Hallelujah. And another thing about Gilgal, when I say the reproach is rolled away, you know, people go through. Maybe this year, 2018, may not have been so pleasant as it was before. Maybe some of us went through difficult times, losing our loved ones. Maybe you became sick so often that you had to run to hospitals. Or you had problems with your children. Children had problems with parents. Husbands had problems with their wives, and wives problems with their husbands. Well, maybe you went through disappointments, failures, so many heartaches. But I tell you, in all those hard times, if not for the hand of God that carried us through, we will not be here. Amen? Why not we give a good hand to the Lord and say, thank you, Jesus, all because of you. We have come to see the end of this year. Amen. He almost carried us through, all through this year. Just like a father will embrace, lift up their child and put them. You know, I love to see my sons treat their babies the way John and Terry, when the baby goes and embraces the father, they just take the child, put them on the shoulder. For their babies, this is the most safest place on the earth. Most secured place is to be on dad's shoulder. I tell you, friends, you and me are in the same way. The most secured, safest place on the shoulders of our Heavenly Father. Come on, give a good hand to the Lord. Hallelujah. When we were kids in a Sunday school, we used to sing a song called Roll the Way, Roll the Way, Roll the Way. I don't know if anybody of my age or here know that song. Well, they know. Thank you. Thank you. Every burden of my heart rolled away. Gilgal is a place to roll all your burdens away. Reproach is away. Shame is taken away. Pain is rolled. Everything is rolled. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you in Gilgal this morning? And I have good news that your reproach is rolled away. God has taken your shame. God has taken your pain. He's bringing you into a new experience. The next experience is renew the covenant with God. You know, Gilgal is a place where the Israelites had to renew their covenant. You know, in the verse, 5th chapter, verse 10, it says, I'll read it for you. Now the children of Israel camped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at twilight on the plains of Jericho. It's very interesting that the people of Israelites did not have their communion like we do every first Sunday of the month. They only had occasionally different experiences. Their first Passover was in the land of Egypt. And the second one is recorded in the 9th chapter of Numbers. This is the third one. At Gilgal, their third experience, their Passover. This is a wonderful experience, you know. The Passover was a memorial of our physical deliverance from Egypt by the sacrifice of the lamb for Israelites. That is what happened, and it is described in the chapter of Exodus 12 chapter. But for you and me, we know we have a Passover. We have a Pascha. We have a new covenant with our God. Amen? Jesus has been sacrificed as a lamb for us. And in 1 Corinthians 5, 7 says, for indeed Christ the Passover was sacrificed for us. Christ made a new covenant for us through his blood by sacrificing himself for you and for me. You know, God wants to have that bond and relationship. Through this Passover, these people made a bond, covenant with God. This is what God wants us, amen, to have that covenantal relationship that we belong to him and he belongs to us, amen. You know, for that he paid such a great price to redeem us from the hands of Satan. That's why don't underestimate the first Sunday when you take the communion. Know that this is the new covenant that Christ has made for you. Amen? That you show to the world and you have that confidence in you that I belong to him and he belongs to me. Hallelujah. You know, just after the day they had the Passover, something happened, very interesting happened was the manna that used to fall from above every day for 40 years, God fed them with manna. But the day the third Passover was celebrated, the next day, the manna, the pouring down of manna stopped. You may wonder, why? You know, there's another interesting thing is God wanted them because they have just entered the entry of the promised land, Gilgal. God said, hey, you're now come into the land of abundance. You no more need this kind of limited provisions. Now you're going to enjoy the fruits of the land. To make it more simple, I would say when they were in Egypt, they were living in the land, not enough. When they were in wilderness, they were living in the kind of experience just enough. You know, manna was provided just for the day's needs. They were allowed to gather the manna only for the day's food. And God told them strictly, not more than that. If they had to save it for the next day, it'll get bad. It was only allowed certain amount for every family. And it was a kind of limited portion. But God wanted these people to experience the land where they can experience more than enough. More than enough and more abundant life. Do you understand this morning? Hallelujah. You know, many of us live in the manna mentality. We always have the manna mentality. Live for this day. Live for this world. What I need, let them provide. And they have a very limited thinking, limited understanding and limited relationship with God. With God, there's no variation or partiality. He's open to have relationship with everyone. But we only make all the difference because we have all this manna mentality. And sometimes we think, it's just enough what the day needs are met. Lord, if you only heal my stomach pain, that's enough. Lord, if you only heal my headache, that's enough. If you provide needs for all my debts that I'm suffering, that's enough. You know, we think in such a limited way. That's not the way God wants to bless us. God wants us to have abundance of His provisions. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Manna is like a survival Christian attitude. To put it more simple, manna mentality Christians, when they get sick, they'll say, oh, where is the pastor? Pastor, I'm sick. Come and pray for me. My stomach pain, my needs, my problems. Where is this one, that one? Come on, pray, 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 pray. They will be begging everyone, looking up for someone for their needs. But that's not the way God wants us to live. God has given us abundance of promises. Provisions in the Bible where you can take hold of everything, experience to its fullness and enjoy a life abundance in Christ. Come on, give a good hand to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Walk into the land of abundance. Some of us think provisions are more important. No, not provisions. Promises are more important. You know, promises of God's word is full of abundance. It'll provide all your needs till the last breath of your life. Not for just this day, for the very end of your life. We are not here looking for alms from people. God wants you to be men and women of authority, where you can exercise rule over situations. Amen? We are not called to be slaves. We don't need to live with a slave drive mentality. We are the sons and daughters of the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when these people understood that, they started to cultivate, they started to eat the fruits of the land, that lifestyle became supernatural, wonderful. Amen. The very moment they entered Gilgal, the news spread all over the enemy's camp. You know, the fifth chapter, first verse says, all the kings of Canaan, people who were against them, when they came to know about this Israelites entering into the land of promise, they began to shake. Their hearts began to melt. I tell you, my friends, if you only know who you are in Christ, the devil trembles. Nothing in the world can ever overcome us. Amen? God doesn't want us to be wanderers in the wilderness. Turn to your friend and say, God doesn't want us to be wanderers in wilderness. God wants us to be conquerors of Cana. Amen? God has called us to be victorious. Amen? Hallelujah for that. My next point is, Gilgal is a place of the revelation of God. When they came to the Gilgal, I love this fifth chapter, the very last verses from 13 to 15, I think. Joshua had a wonderful encounter. We know that Moses had a wonderful encounter before he led the people out from the land of Egypt. God had to give him an encounter by the burning bush. and where God revealed to Moses, and I am that I am. I'm all to you. Well, each one of us have to have an encounter with God. Are you with me this morning? And I think Pastor Terry preached such wonderful sermons this year of different encounters. How many have been blessed? How many of you have experienced that encounter with God? Give a good hand to the Lord. I recommend, I believe every one of us need to have an encounter. If you don't have an encounter, you don't have a direct relationship with your Father. You live a second-grade life only. If you have an encounter with God, you live a life victorious, knowing who you are and who your God is. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank God for that. When this man, Joshua, had a wonderful encounter with God, you know, he saw that angel, the God, commander of the army of the Lord, he was standing with a sword in his hand. And as soon as Joshua saw him, he really was so scared, and maybe. And he asked him a question: are you a friend or foe? Are you on our side or are you on the enemy's side? It was a very silly, or we think it's a silly question. I don't know what I would have asked at such kind of moments. Maybe a similar question. Well, this man asked God that kind of question. You know, the answer what God gave him is so wonderful. So wonderful, he said, I'm neither on your side or on the enemy's side. I'm the captain of the Lord. Amen? I am from above. It simply means to me is, hey, some of us think God is for our needs. God, I'm going there this morning. Come with me. Help me. Do this for me. We want to use God for our purposes. We want God to do this and that. We want to dictate and direct God. God, do this for me. Take care of my needs. Take care of my exams. Take care of my job. We go on with the list. What we want God to do. No. God doesn't want us to exercise that way. God wants us in the rather way we sang, I surrender all. Lord, what is your wish for me? What do you want me to do? That should be our kind of attitude. This is what Paul said when he had an encounter with the Lord. First question he asked, who are you, Lord? The second one's, what would you want me to do? Here, when Joshua had that kind of encounter with the Lord, God answered in such a beautiful way. He said, I'm neither on your side. All that you have to do is come on my side. Come and stand with me. Come follow me. God is not for our good, but we are created for his purposes. We are living in this world to fulfill his commission, his will, his desire, his purposes, his directions, his guidance is the most important thing of our life. Amen? What a beautiful encounter that was. You know, God knew that Joshua was chosen as a vessel, a kind of vessel who will lead many battles and who will bring down so many kingdoms and who will take victory almost over 31 kings. He's going to possess the land of the promise, and he's going to distribute the land of the promises as inheritances to all the tribes of Israel. That was God's plan and idea for Joshua. So for Joshua's need and life, all that God wanted to say is, hey Joshua, don't worry about your future. Don't worry about 2019. Don't worry about this and that. I'm here as a captain to lead you into the next phase of your life, to lead you into the next level of your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why not we lift up our hands and say, this morning, King of Kings, the Lord of Lords is standing here to say, don't panic, don't worry, don't be anxious about 2019. You're not going to face it on your own. I'm the one who's going to lead you. I'm going to be the captain. I'm going to be the guide. I'm going to be your provider. I'm going to be all in all for you. I'm the one who's going to do the lead. All that you have to do is just follow me. Just follow me. Just follow me. That's what God is trying to say this morning through this passage to each and every one of us. We may have many of our own dreams sitting, Lord, do this, do that, that. No, God has more greater, higher things than what you are dreaming and expecting. Are you ready for that? Or you want to limit God to your standard, or you want to be raised up to God's standard? Hallelujah. We want to be raised up to God's standard. The one who's going to lead the battle, the one who's going to be my captain, is going to do everything. Jericho is going to be so simple. Amen. Just with a praise and shout, the walls of Jericho will go down. It's not because of our battle skills, all because of the captain who's going to lead us. Hallelujah. The one who's leading us is great and powerful. I tell you, church, the captain is here to lead us to 2019. He's the one who's going to lead us. We don't know what 2019 holds for us, but we know who our captain is. We know who's going to lead us. He's all in all to us this morning. Hallelujah. You know what? As soon as he asked him that question, the Lord also said, hey, remove your sandals. The place you're standing is holy ground. We think literally, remove your shoes. Because we live in a country where in many places like temples and other things, they follow certain kinds of beliefs and things. But you know, but here it refers in a different way. Change your position. So far, you've been your own leader. Now, surrender. Give up your shoes. Give up your position. Come, surrender. Follow where I'm going to lead you. No more your own identity. Take my identity. Follow my lead. No more your will, no more your desires. All that we need to say is, here, Lord, I surrender. Lead me in 2019 the way you want me to go. You know all about 2019. We are sitting here this morning wondering how it's going to be. But one thing is for sure, he has already prepared everything for us in 2019. Every minute, every second is under his control. Everything is under his subjection. But all that we need to do this morning is, just like Joshua, fell at the feet of the captain and say, here we are, Lord, lead us through. What happened? Joshua was the best successful leader where he was able to take all the Israelites into the promised land, and they were able to possess, enjoy the promise and the inheritances that God designed and destined for them. Until this day, Israel is a testimony for that. Amen. And I want you to know this morning that we need to have an experiences like Gilgal. Amen. Do you have an altar of remembrance and thanksgiving? So many things that God has done in our lives. Count your blessings, name them one by one, and it'll surprise you to see what the Lord has done. So many, 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 many blessings he has done all through 2018. All that was from his hand. Second is, he's removed all the reproaches, the shame, the pain, disappointments, failures, everything is rolled away. Hallelujah for that. And we are here to renew our covenant relationship with God. That is the most important thing in this world for us, to build that covenantal relationship. And the most very important thing is to have the revelation. Not through some leaders or through somebody. You need to have, every one of us need to have, that personal revelation of who God is to us. For Joshua needed to know his God was the captain of his army. Captain of all the battles that he's going to face. Amen. Hallelujah. For each and every individual, whatever your needs may be, what are your challenges may be, he's there to fulfill that. For Abraham, he was Jehovah Jireh. For Moses, he was Jehovah Nissi. For Gideon, he was Jehovah Shalom. He was all in all. My God can take all the places of my needs in life.